Hi friends, I'm Chloe and you're listening to the Beware Podcast. Hi Crystal, welcome to the podcast and to the YouTube channel. How are you today?
I'm very good. Thank you very much for having me.
It's a pleasure. I'm really excited about this discussion that we're going to have today. But first, for anyone in my audience that may not know you already, do you mind presenting yourself very quickly?
Of course. So my name is Crystal Mbosso. I'm 25 years old. I was born and I grew up in Switzerland, and then 6 years ago, I moved to London to study fashion. So I'm now a menswear designer, and I have an African background. So my mom is from the Congo, the Democratic Republic of the Congo, and my dad is from Angola.
Amazing. So we really wanted to do this episode together because we wanted to talk about first, obviously, what's happening in the world right now regarding racism. It's a very interesting and important topic, and I feel like no one I could speak better about this topic than you. And also because we wanted to link it again with the fashion industry and just share a few information about that. And you have like a background and you're into that field at the moment. So I thought it would be really interesting. So what's your personal experience studying and working in the fashion industry as a Black person?
I think the first and biggest thing that I've experienced is a complete lack of representation. Like, it is insane when you see the amounts. So for example, let's start with university. So university, I think that's the only good thing they do, is that there's a big, there's a lot of diversity in the students. They accept students from everywhere, a lot of international students, because international fees are much higher. it's true. But yes, they accept students of all colors and all genders, and which is great. But then when it comes, well, clearly in 5 years of, so I studied for 5 years, fashion design, I've had two Black tutors. That's it. And all the other Black workers were technicians or security staff, which are obviously the lowest paid positions. Mm-hmm. But other than that, yeah, all my design tutors, my pattern cutting tutors, my historical culture tutors, like they were all white, all of them. So a complete lack of representation here, and honestly, there's some pretty racist things that happened at school as well, at uni, sorry. And they're not, you know, again, they're not like the, you know, I spit on your face racist, but mm-hmm. I think when you have such a multicultural university and you're actually benefiting from the amount of diverse culture and also all those international fees, you know, you're benefiting from all of this. Mm-hmm. I think you have to be clever into how you teach your students and how your teachers are embracing all those cultures, mm-hmm. which is not the case at the moment, which is really sad. I personally haven't actually experienced that many racist things, but especially other minorities, Indians or, you know, Chinese students, I've heard horrible things, you know, and that's from a university that's like one of the top in the world in fashion. Yeah. Like, this is not acceptable. Yeah. So in terms of uni, that was pretty much that. I was mainly shocked at the amount of Black tutors I had. When you think of how many, you know, Black designers they train, That's, you know, so strange to me. But
Yeah.
then, so my experience in fashion so far has mainly been internships. And once again, I've most of the time been the only black person in the team. Then I have to say though, like I haven't, I think the design teams, at least in the companies I've been to, because they're mostly, I feel like when you're in fashion, you're very supportive of the LGBTQA plus community. So you know, you that's not really, I feel like an environment where they would be really racist. But at the same time, if there is no representation of minorities, this is how you end up with monkey faces on the runway, or black faces here and there, or cultural appropriation, because
Yeah.
there's no one to say this is
This
not
is
okay,
wrong.
or
Yeah.
only person that's there to say that is an intern who has no power, you know. But I'm gonna go over cultural appropriation a bit later. I just want to finish about representation. I think there's a massive problem also in internships, which is why, you know, there's really not that many other minorities represented, is because most of the internships in fashion design are unpaid. And,
Wow.
you know, for example, my first, so I did a year of placement and my first internship was paid, but it didn't even cover my rent. So I had to work during weekends like crazy hours to be able to survive. That's not something that's available to everyone. And my second internship was completely unpaid, which, you know, not a lot of people can afford that. I managed because I was working like crazy, but I was also absolutely exhausted every single day. And again, you know, this is why you end up with more a predominantly white industry. And because the opportunities we get are, you know, they're not available for everyone. There's a big problem of nepotism as well, which it's, you know, a lot of internships, even when I was there and they were like trying to fill other internship positions, they would first go into their own contacts and look at, you know, their friends or their, you know, friends of friends or whatever, which doesn't really give the opportunity for other students to, you know, get the chance to actually get an internship. So, yeah, there's a few problems there. The most, you know, racist experiences I felt when I was interning was mostly the, you know, the jokes, the passive aggressive, you know, comments that I'm not racist, but I'm gonna say this and it's a joke, so don't take it seriously, you know. And when you're the only black person there, like, how do you defend yourself?
Yeah, no, that's true. Yeah, so to jump back on what we were saying earlier, the lack of representation and diversity in the companies, a lot of the manager positions are held by white people. And another thing that I've noticed a lot is lack of diversity in the model industry.
100%. There is a massive lack of representation there. There's been a couple in the past couple of years. I've seen a couple of, especially in London, again because we're a multicultural city. But I've seen a couple of model agencies that are pushing on hiring, you know, diverse models. But I find it, I don't even know. It's a bit of a top subject for me because I think, you know, if you're a designer and you're designing a collection that's targeted towards any female or any male, and you know the inspiration comes from, I don't know, something European or whatever, I think there should be a representation on the runway. And at the moment, it's not really the case for most brands. Most of the brands that have posted Black Lives Matter on their, you know, Instagrams. But it's kind of sad. And also, you know, so for example, with my brands, we at the moment, we like to empower and represent the black men. So, for example, when I was showing my collection or shooting my collection, I would always request black models, and I found that that was actually an issue. They just couldn't find any, which was so crazy, and they couldn't guarantee me that they would find black models. And I'd be like, "Excuse me, we're in London. How can you tell me you can't find black models? Like, this is this." And it's not like I need 20, I needed four.
No, and out of like, yeah, I understand. I think that there is a part of this, like when you think about like, oh, an agency is based there, and you know, probably the black community, maybe the black population in that specific city, doesn't represent 50%. So obviously, in terms of percentage of just calculation, it's not as easy to find black models, just because there's less black people in the community itself, you know. But it's not a reason, you know, like to not to try. And also, just I feel like some brands are just doing it out of ignorance or even on purpose. Just, you know.
There's definitely some brands that do it on purpose. I feel like also there's been a little shift at the moment because, now the black body sells, but it's kind of at their own,
Profit.
with their own rules and at their own profit. It's only when it's trendy that they will, portray some black people, not all black people, some black people. Usually the black people they would use, it would be of light color, never very dark color, because apparently, according to them, obviously very black is ugly, but or mixed race. But it's, there's a lot of examples of models or celebrities that had to shoot for whoever, and they've had the hair and makeup team make their skin look lighter or photoshopped it to make it look lighter, because they want to have that diversity. But still, if you're a bit lighter, you're more acceptable and you sell more. So it's quite messed up, to be honest. But
Well, I guess just the modeling industry as a whole, like it's just in the end, like it's just using people, white or black or people of color, anyways. But yeah, to that point, like I mean, there's probably white people who have been like put their makeup on like even whiter, you know. Let's say they got a tan and they were wearing it wasn't suiting the look. But I understand how I can understand this is something that's very present, and something that black or people of color, like mixed race models, experience more, and maybe to an extent, it's like it does look completely different. It does not just slightly a lighter sometimes.
yeah, it's like a complete different skin tone. But also, to go back to models and the challenges the black models face, is also again lack of representation in the hair and makeup industry for them. There's loads of stories that they go on a photo shoot or prep for a runway show, and they have to do their own makeup and their own hair because no one knows how to do it. And then, when I go and ask my friends that studied hair and makeup at my uni, they do not learn how to do it on any other, color, any other community than the white community. They do not learn anything else.
That's so crazy.
It's crazy. And again, a university that take on so many diverse students, then for example, I have a hair and makeup girl that I absolutely love. She's called Frankie and she's black, and she studied at that university. She had to learn everything for black people outside of university. So she
That's
goes
so
into uni
dumb.
and she doesn't even learn how to do hair and makeup on herself, which is insane to me. But the next thing I want to talk about regarding obviously racism in the fashion industry is cultural appropriation, because it's been a big topic for a lot of years. But a couple of I think last year, a bit longer than last year ago, I've realized that it's clearly not understood by a lot of people. Why I'm saying that is because I was at uni, I was talking to my design tutor, I was having a crit, and we were talking about my collection, and I was asking him advices on how to not fall into the cultural appropriation bracket, because obviously I'm telling a story of African people, which sometimes is not my own story, sometimes it's not even for my own country, you know. And I didn't want to do it in a disrespectful way, so I went, you know, to him and asked him during the crit, like, what can I do to make sure like I don't fall into this? And he basically justified cultural appropriation to me, and I was like, no, but what you don't understand is I don't actually think this is okay. But he justified cultural appropriation to me. And
What?
I just, you know, silently listened to him, and in my head thought he was an absolute idiot. But
Oh, God.
I was like, but I was thinking, you know, luckily I'm educated on the subject enough to realize that what he's saying is completely wrong. But not everyone is. And what if, you know, someone else who didn't know about this subject asked him that, and he said, yes, well, you know, it's okay to take from another person's culture and then basically justify cultural appropriation to them. They're going to think it's okay, and then they're going to do it.
Yeah, exactly. I think it's okay to do it in a respectful way, but it's not okay to do it like, and not, you have to do a lot of research and being aware of what you're doing before doing it, because that, like, obviously it could be easily seen as cultural appropriation, and it's very difficult to do it in the right way.
It is it you know, it requires much more effort. Obviously you have to acknowledge like the people that have actually you know, brought this culture to you. You have to celebrate them somehow, you know, either by showing them on a runway, on the runway, instead of showing the clothes that have been inspired by black people, instead of showing them on white people, maybe, you know, include a few black models to show, you know, where that comes from. Or by, or mention the artist, mention the community that you inspired yourself from. You know, you can't just take something from someone else's culture, and especially in minorities' cultures, because the problem with that is basically the whole society tells us that what makes us black is considered as thug, or, you know, ghetto, or urban, you know, or those words that they've invented to politically correctly talk about us, you know. But then you're going to take that one thing and make it trendy and make profit out of it without actually like helping the community.
That's called stealing.
That is, it's so wrong, and it's happened so many times, you know. And oh my God, the biggest example, which is not necessarily in the fashion industry, but is in the music industry. It's happened over and over again with rock and roll, jazz, you know, everything. But in the fashion industry, it happens a lot, because obviously you've got influencers that think it's okay to go in Coachella with, you know, with things that they think are like urban or whatever, but then they make it trendy and they think it's okay, but it's really not.
Could you give a few examples for anyone who's not really familiar with that term of cultural appropriation? Like, what are some things that you've seen over and over white people do that are considered cultural appropriation, but people just are doing it and either they don't realize it, they're completely ignorant, or they do it nevertheless?
So there's a couple of things. The biggest example I think I've seen recently was the Indian American Indian Native people. You know, they have head pieces. It's been used a lot as a trendy piece for, you know, for whatever looks, which is so disrespectful, especially after what they've been through in America. for example, Black communities. So I have the, you know, the little, there's a really good trend at the moment in hair and makeup to have, you know, baby hair at the front. You put gel in it and you like it. That's a Black thing that's been completely stolen. Or actually, probably the biggest one of all, braids.
Yeah, I was going to say that.
Braids. You know, originally, like, this is something I've actually learned recently. Originally, so you've had slaves coming into Europe in America. Braids have been a thing that's been a part of African culture for a very, very long time. It's even, it even used to be used as to, like, identify different tribes. So they would do different like types of braids and different patterns of braids in their hair to identify themselves as I'm part of this tribe. Then obviously they came into Europe and they had those braids, which were beautiful. And I don't know if you know, but there's a lot of trade owners, male trade owners, that were raping the slaves, women slaves, and the women married to those men would think that the braids are what attracts the men. So then there's been a law passed for women slaves to wear head scarves. So, you know, Black women wearing headscarves is actually a thing that comes from slavery, which is, that's what I've learned recently. I didn't know that either. And I wore some sometimes, you know, and I didn't know that either. And so that's what they did to basically try and keep their men back to themselves. And then suddenly braiding white hair became popular and it stayed for hundreds of years. And it's crazy because I find it insane. I find it insane. But I guess braids is something that's a bit more acceptable on everyone now. But when you think about where it came from, it's actually insane.
Yeah, I think that's something really important and interesting mentioning, because stealing others people's ideas is very common in the fashion industry. But also stealing each other's cultures without respect. That's the biggest problem of all in it. What I want to talk about now is about the how we are treating people in the fashion industry regarding, you know, sweatshops, fast fashion, and then all of where all these clothes end up going once us rich white people and privileged don't want to use them anymore because they're not trendy, you know, and I feel like all that is really is linked to each other. So
it completely is linked to each other, 100%. It's so, first of all, there's a lot of obviously sweatshops in poorer countries, in Indian countries, in African countries, but this is a thing that's also happening in America and in Europe. Like in the UK, I can't quite remember the data, but I've seen like there's actually, I think half of the textiles workers actually get paid, and most of the ones that don't get paid are obviously from a minority. But even, you know, this concept of going into other poorer countries to develop products for Europe, for privileged people, basically, and not pay them properly, not pay them at all, and completely exploit them in doing so, it's basically another term for slavery. when you think about it, it's another way of using slavery and hiding it and putting it onto the capitalist hat, you know. But it's terrible what's happening, and it's really sad. And I think people don't realize how many brands are enabling this kind of practices, which is terrible. And, you know, for example, with this coronavirus situation, it's even worse because they've, loads of brands have put in so many really high orders for next collections with those factories. Those people have been working around the clock, sometimes with in terrible condition, you know. And then all the brands, in light of the coronavirus, decided to just cancel their orders. So those factories are left with hundreds and hundreds of like stock of clothes they do not know what to do with. And they're not getting paid for all the work they've done.
Yeah, that's completely like I think that well, obviously that's an issue, you know, whether like we should not be treating anyone like this, like, but we have to still remember and take into account that most sweatshops, as you mentioned, are located in developing and poor countries because, yeah, the manufacturing cost is a lot lower and a lot more profitable for these brands. But that being said, a lot of the people who produce our clothes are Asian people of color or black people. And the issue is that, well, we buy these clothes. Not really thinking about first where they came from, who made them, and under what condition. We use these clothes. We don't treat our clothes properly. We don't cherish them. We just buy them for the sake of a trend. And then we toss it, we throw it away. And where all that clothes then goes back is to Africa.
There's two massive problems with this, with the waste we have. There's first of all, we send our clothes, you know, as a charitable a charitable thing. We send our clothes back to those countries. First of all, that destroys the textile industries in those countries completely, because where I'm not talking garments, I'm talking hundreds and hundreds and thousands of kilos per month. It's ridiculous. We destroy the industry there. We basically get rid of our waste and give it to some other people, and then they have to deal with this waste themselves, which is also a thing. There's actual waste being dispatched into underdeveloped countries, and then they have to deal with waste they haven't even produced, which is ridiculous. There's so many issues with this. But again, you know, the fact that, oh, let's just give my clothes that I don't want anymore to other people. That's another form of racism. I'm sorry. Different thing, you know, of obviously I'm the first one to go and give my some of my clothes to charity shops, because first of all, they're called charity shops and they have an actual industry on how to store and sell those garments. But then just shipping them to Africa, not really, you know, thinking about what
Who's gonna wear it?
exactly.
It's just gonna end up being burnt there.
Exactly. It's going to end up being burned there. So literally sending waste to other undeveloped countries, like they don't have enough problems already. And then they'll have to deal with those wastes, which are not even theirs. And it's so unfair. And it's again, another, you know, it's another thing that enables systematic racism. And it just continues, and it's, as you said before, it's really ingrained into our society to the point that it's completely ingrained in the fashion industry, 100%. That's how we make profit.
So regarding that, I wanted to ask you more about your personal project regarding your brand, because you're doing something really like different, and the message behind it is fighting everything that the fashion industry is doing right now. So yeah, could you tell us more about what your brand is, and why did you choose to do menswear specifically for black men?
So, first of all, so Maison Bosso is an African bespoke contemporary menswear brand. We basically have two collections a year. We inspire ourselves from African culture, old and new. We love to rediscover African garments and work on them to make them a bit more contemporary. We love to work with African artisans and try to help the community, the textile communities in Africa as well, which has been so inspiring so far, because there's just so many talents. Then they don't even realize their talents, and yeah, the brand focuses on being sustainable and ethical, of course. And yeah, it's been a great project so far. I feel like it's been, I feel like I should have known all along, because it's been like the development of my life and what I've missed myself, representation of having clothes that are a bit more contemporary, but represent my heritage as well. And so, yeah, I feel like I should have seen this coming, but somehow I didn't. But yeah, so this is Maison Bosso. Why we do specifically menswear for Black men? So menswear is purely a design thing, actually. It's just, as a designer, I somehow do not like designing women's wear. Simply because I feel like I find women's wear too overwhelming. There's too many things that can be done, because women are a bit more daring when it comes to fashion. So they're happy to wear things that are a bit more extravagant. And my mind is just too overwhelmed when I think of that. But then menswear is a bit more traditional. So, a t-shirt is a t-shirt, but then there's a lot of thought process that goes into what kind of fabrics you're going to use and what kind of finishes you're gonna do on that t-shirt. And I'm fascinated by little details and finishings and having fabrics that are, suitable for your everyday, but are also comfortable and sustainable. And yeah, I really love that. So that's why I decided to do menswear. And for Black men, because I really feel like they really lack representation, and there's only one image of them that's been portrayed through fashion and also the media, which is wrong, and which I've learned through my own father, who's an absolute, he loves fashion so much, it's actually crazy, probably more than I do. So yeah, I guess I've always been inspired by this, and that's why I wanted to focus into this particular industry.
That's amazing. I love it. I think what you're doing is so unique and one of its kind. I really like how you tie all different aspects of ethics and sustainability in it. Like you're really present on all aspects, and I think that's something that's really important. Because as a brand, you have a responsibility. I also really like the fact that you only decided to work with black models. I've seen, collections with a mixed race and like different, like white and black and both, and a little bit of a diversity, but only black models. I think it just adds to, the message and the look and the what you want behind it, and it shows your respect for your inspiration behind the clothing that you're producing. Because you're actually deciding to work with people from that specific community on background.
Exactly. And basically, my consumer is always my first thought every time I have to make a decision. And even, my fit model, for example. So for those who don't know, a fit model is the model that's gonna try all your clothes during the development of your collection. So, and then you're gonna grade sizes from that sample size. So my fit model, is Caribbean, and he's got a body type that is much more African than a white person would necessarily be, because I'm thinking of my consumer first, and I'm thinking, you know, there is really not that many brands that, you know, have a fit model that has a body type that is more like them. So that might be also a lot more difficult for them to find clothes that fits them properly. And yeah, every time I'm making a decision, I have my consumer in mind because it's time, you know, they get celebrated a bit more.
Yeah, I agree. So I have two more questions regarding Maison Boso. The first one is, was there any obstacles that you encountered in creating this brand and with the values that it has?
Yeah, I think at the very beginning, one of the first obstacle I had was people actually understanding and seeing the potential of an idea like this. Because this project started as my final year collection. For my final year project, I had to build a brand and then make a collection for it, which was our first collection. And I remember pitching the idea to my friends and stuff, and they couldn't understand it. Some of them jumped on board straight away, but also some of them were like, luxury for African people? That's a terrible idea. You're never going to sell anything. And I'm like, actually, there's a big market for African luxury, and there's a lot of people happy to spend the money in African luxuries products. But they just couldn't believe it because they saw Africa as, you know, poorest continent in the world, so they didn't think that I would actually sell anything. The other issue I think I faced was in terms of building this project at university, it was the amount of research I needed to do, and there was really not that many books or resources for me to find things. Or even when I remember I had to do the first sort of presentations on what the brand would be, I had no imagery to show what I meant, you know. I had nothing. So I had to, you know, obviously then I ended up shooting my collections a few times, and now I have imagery to show. But it was difficult because, as you say, it's a unique like concept and idea. So it was really, I felt like I was working from nothing.
But that's exciting too, in a way.
That's super exciting, but it's also a challenge, I think, because to make people understand that there is value in this project is problematic when there's no examples of success before me.
Well, you're gonna be the first one. And finally, my last question, which is a little bit more broad and to end up on something maybe a little bit more open, is how do you see the fashion industry moving forward, and what do you think are the biggest things that need to change right now?
I think the biggest thing that needs to change and that will help solve a lot of problems is fashion. The fashion industry needs to slow down big time. Like the amount of collections that is required per luxury brands, and then the amount of garments that high street brands put out every year is ridiculous. And this is how we end up in patterns of unsustainable practices, unethical practices, copying each other because designers don't even have time to think about the next collection, you know. And I think if the industry actually slows down and learns how to make profit in other ways, for example, in offering I don't know, studios to fix your clothes, you know. For example, you buy a clothes somewhere and a year later there's a hole or whatever and you go and they fix it. That could generate another source of revenue, and that could like bridge that gap. But I think that's the main issue which I'm trying to focus on with Maison Boso. But I think in order to get an actual change in the whole industry in all aspects, this needs to change massively. But also, obviously, we need a lot more diversity in the industry, especially since, you know, fashion doesn't really have borders, you know, it's a bit of a worldwide thing. Yeah. So we definitely need designers from all backgrounds. And, you know, in magazines and in other companies, we need people of all ethnicities. And that's going to change things, hopefully. Yeah. But as you said, it starts with educating people. So, yeah, universities probably have to be the first to change, I guess.
Yeah, because they're definitely educating like upcoming and new designers that will be making clothes moving forward. So,
yeah. But shocking thing is that in 5 years of studying fashion, I had one sustainability course. Not wow. even course, class.
Yeah.
It was, I don't know, 2 hours or something in yeah. the last, in final year. That's it.
Yeah. That's the problem, because like if you really wanted to dig deeper into that topic, and if you really want to have your brand like with sustainable values and ethical values, you have to do all the work yourself. And that's a big issue, I think. Oh, well, thank you so much, Christelle. What a lovely, interesting conversation. It was very meaningful information and experience that you've shared on here. And I'm really thankful and grateful that you agreed to be on the podcast and on the YouTube channel. Yeah, thank you so much.
Absolute pleasure. It was a great chat, honestly.
I hope it was interesting for everyone who listened to it and learned some new things today. And thank you, Christelle.